We're talking all things the economy, gold, and silver with Todd and Bubba Horwitz of BubbaTrading.com. Happy Thanksgiving. Thank you for speaking with us today. Most people are taking a day off, but not you, not Todd. Always trading, always on the ball. Thank you for being here.
Hey, David, it's always great to be with you. You know, the markets are open and for another few minutes, so we gotta be available, baby.
All right, let's start with the markets then. Gold is flat today, silver as well. Nice run we've had over the last couple of weeks, reaching the $1,800 level, which was a key resistance level for a lot of people. We hit that, we're below $1,800 now. What's going on right here? Are we consolidating? What's holding gold back from just breaking past that point?
Well, I think, first of all, you did reach some pretty critical levels in actually gold, silver, and platinum, and they failed, which is not a total surprise. Right now, they're in pretty nasty downtrends, and we could see some lower action ahead, you know, before we resume another rally. But one of the big drops in gold and silver especially is the reappointment of Chair Powell. You know, the interest rate policy is going to change here, which will have a direct effect on precious metals. Because, you know, if they're going to continue with this cheap or free money or quantitative easing without raising interest rates, then, you know, then gold and silver would be strong. But when they're going to have to start raising to combat the inflation unless they decide to do what really is right later.
It's interesting because you've got a bit of a dichotomy here. And I know you offline, I've talked offline, I know you personally. So you've got, you don't like the more radical progressive agendas, fiscally or monetarily speaking, but you're saying those agendas might actually be better for gold and silver because of looser monetary and fiscal policies, right?
100%. They would be much better for gold, but they'd be horrible for the world economy. They'd be horrible for the United States, and they would turn the United States into a socialist country or a communist country and be under the rule of somebody like China. Because when you give everything away, you know, we have systematically given control back to China, Saudi Arabia, and Russia. We are no longer the world power we were because we have no control. Nobody listens to what we say, so our big stick does no longer carry. Once you give up the control of the number one key commodity on the globe, besides food, which is oil, okay, you are looking for a lot of trouble. And that is why we're seeing so many dramatic price rises in the price of gas and the price of oil. But for gold and silver, sure, you know, Lael Brainard as the Fed chair, which is who the progressive wanted, gold might go to 2,500 right away because, again, their agenda is to continue to give stimulus. And I believe, in my opinion, the whole situation that we're watching here was designed to get universal basic income. And that's why they never did anything else. And that's the problem, because you cannot have that. Only two groups of the population like that, and that is the very rich that will no longer be affected, will have no competition, and the very poor will get something for nothing.
Well, I've read that with the reappointment of Jay Powell, the Fed might have to bench some of these more progressive ideas like UBI, potentially even Fedcoin down the line. So do you see this as being sort of a hiatus moment for some of these ideas?
Oh, I think that the progressives took a good kick in the teeth when Powell was reappointed, that it's going to really change their entire agenda. And not to mention, you know, it's a year away, but the next election, you know, the country is on very much unrest here, and there is a lot of problems and issues here. But one thing you cannot do, you cannot affect people's money and what they pay. And, you know, even though they report these inflation numbers, which are total garbage, but it's 6.4%. But of course, they exclude the two biggest expenses that every American family has, or every family in the world has, which is fuel and energy and food. So if you take that out, if you put that in the equation, you got inflation at about 15 to 20%, and wage growth is at about 4.5%. So not a very good mix considering you're working in a negative factor.
The fact that Biden sided more with the moderates this time in terms of his picks for the Fed, at least, what does that signal in terms of his political agenda now? Does that foreshadow anything to you of what he might do for the up till now till the midterms?
Well, I think he's going to try to do things to settle down much of the anger that's in the country, which I don't think he'll be able to do. Here's the bottom line. Historically, the House changes very dramatically during a midterm election. In this one, especially because of what's going on. So I think what they're trying to do now, they're trying to do some damage control to not have these elections swing dramatically back, because they do have an agenda and they would like to rewrite the Constitution, which is another total bunch of garbage. Okay. That you know, they want to change where we are.
What do you mean they're rewriting the Constitution?
They would like to rewrite. I didn't say they were. They would like to rewrite the Constitution. They've already taken down statues. Wait till they go after Mount Rushmore and start taking down those guys off of Mount Rushmore. You know, this is a very serious matter, because they're trying to erase the history. And we all know what happens when you forget what happens in history. You are doomed to repeat it. And that is exactly where we're headed, because they're making things up that don't exist.
Okay, well, let's talk about inflation now. So inflation, 6.2%. I can't remember if we've talked, you and I, actually we haven't. We haven't talked since the last CPI print came out. So this didn't surprise a lot of people that inflation actually did rise above the previous all-time high. Now, where are we headed from here? Same level, higher, or do you think it'll potentially wane?
This will depend on the Federal Reserve. Okay, this will depend on interest rates. And they're going to have to slow inflation by raising rates or going back to fracking and shale producing. Okay. And I don't think they're going to go back to their fracking and shale so fast. So there's going to have to be, rates are going to have to be hiked automatically. And the banks themselves are signaling much higher interest rates, because if you've watched the banks trade the last few days, you know, since this has happened, they have already rallied fairly dramatically from the sell-offs they had, because of course their profits will go up with higher interest rates. But I think that's what's going to happen. And I think we're in a real danger of stagflation, which will take us back to the Jimmy Carter era. And I don't know that we're going to get to 10 or 15 or 18% interest rates, but we are accustomed to less than one. And if you go up to six, suddenly the housing market starts to suffer, because you can't sell home housing anymore, because you know, we're a by the month society. Higher rates will hurt. And of course, it will hurt the government, which is another problem, because it's $75 billion a month. Every quarter point hike is the debt service that they have to pay.
The housing market's going to suffer from higher interest rates. Like, what do you mean by suffer?
What happens, you know, listen, we aren't really houses. You know, we have a hot housing market, which has slowed quite a bit. But housing goes up when interest rates go down, because people can afford the monthly payment. So they make the upgrade to a more expensive home. Well, now the price of homes are going to drop, because the interest rates are going to make the payments automatically higher. It's a vicious circle. So what you're really seeing here is that the lousy monetary supply that we have practiced for the last 20 years or 30 years, going back to Greenspan, actually it's 41 years, but for the last 41 years is to, you know, pump into the money supply and artificially inflate assets that are not worth what they're being priced at. But because of the cost of money, people buy them. And that's why you had such a hot housing market.
Do you think that if the housing market overall across the country, I know they're, you know, it's dependent on the jurisdiction, but let's just say overall the housing market slows down a bit, corrects a little bit, what's that going to do to consumer discretionary spending? Because I've read that people tie in their discretionary spending with their net wealth, so to speak, on paper. If your house is worth more, you think you're richer, so you spend more, right? So there's a correlation there.
You're 100% right in that, you know, listen, I get 5 emails a day from different places that, you know, refinance, take the money out, spend it. And that's going to change, because it's going to change the value of the house, you know. And in certain parts of the country, like where I live in Illinois right now, I can't even sell my house. Nobody wants to buy it. And I'm already taking about a $300,000 haircut from a house I bought at the bottom in 2009. But nobody wants to live in Illinois. So there are some sectors that are still very hot, like my home in Vegas. On the other hand, it's up 50% in 2 years. So that's again, there's a whole bunch of things that we don't get privy to reports. And of course, government reports are worthless anyways, because they're always adjusted later.
All right. We've talked about the bad and the ugly. Let's talk about the good. What good news do we have? What direction is the country taking that maybe would put a smile on Todd Bubba Horwitz's face?
You know, I got to be honest with you. Right now, there is nothing that is making me smile, because between higher taxes that they're going to try to, you know, the thought of it was $400,000 above, that's a bunch of crock. I mean, it's going to be, everybody's going to be paying high taxes for those who pay taxes. So I think that we will come out of it. Look, America is strong. We've gone through tough times before, but it's not, there's nothing really to grab onto. As long as the progressives have an agenda, they get nothing done in government anyways. The only thing they've gotten done in the last 5 years is to take a raise during COVID when nobody else was working. Okay. So I don't see them doing anything. I think the government is breaking down. I think the process is breaking down, and there's not a lot to get excited about with, you know, that I can look to the future and say, this is going to be great. Now talk to me, you know, after the next elections. And if we can at least, you know, I don't have a political party affiliation myself, but I hate when either party has all three houses. And I think we need that to split, and then I'll have some more excitement. But right now, it's going to be a long year waiting for this next election, I think.
Well, the economy overall is not normalizing. Is it not moving in a direction?
No, the economy's in horrible shape. It's really? No. It's all, look, you can't get people to work. You go to a drive-through, you can't go inside because they got no help. Okay, they're closing restaurants because they can't get help. People don't want to work. There's 11 million open jobs and 9 million people unemployed, but they don't want to work because they get this stimulus money. The stimulus money is the worst ever that you could ever ask for, because the only people who pay for the stimulus are the middle class. So we get taxed higher to pay these people to stay home and do nothing. And I'm tired of watching people sit on their ass and eat bonbons watching TV while I'm working. I don't like that. That is not what I had in mind when I went to work back, you know, 50 years ago.
Maybe now's the time to invest in robotics companies. Maybe in the future, employers will be sick of putting up vacancy sites and just fill in those positions with robots.
Just so you know, they already have done a lot of that. And for example, Domino's Pizza has a machine now that can, they can have one employee in the store now. They have one machine that not only makes the pizza, boxes it, and has it ready to go. And someday you might see a whole store without, it'll be like a vending machine. You order your pizza and it'll make it for you and it'll pop it right out of a slot.
Okay. Maybe that's something to look forward to. Who knows? Oh, we're living in back to the future days. All right, let's close it back on gold and silver. Let's factor all this in. So you're bearish overall on the economic and socio-political landscape. You're I'm guessing you're bearish on the dollar as well. Inflation's a problem for you. How do you feel about gold and silver now?
I think the dollar is going to rally, just so you understand.
Because, oh,
you
know, really? Dollar, okay.
It's still the but dollar.
How can we have that, Todd? How can we have a decline of the American empire, a decline of American strength, but also a rallying dollar? Explain that dichotomy.
No problem. The dollar is still the reserve currency of the world. Okay, and as long as it remains the reserve currency, when there are fears out there, you know, people talk about the VIX index, for example. They talk about gold and silver, you know, when things go bad. Money runs to the treasury bonds and to the U.S. dollar, because those are still considered the safest places to put money in times of turmoil. Now, as far as gold and silver, look, I think for the next week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, I have no idea. We're in a downtrend. But I think it's a great opportunity for those who invest in precious metals to be buying physical metals. I'm not a big fan of trying to accumulate paper gold or paper silver. I think that's a mistake. I think you have to take money that you can afford. I think you have to take money and you can start buying and nibbling and starting to store precious metals, because they will have a much greater value at some point down the road. And I'm very bullish over history, but I'm just not bullish right now. But I'm still a buyer of physical metals, and I am never selling my physical metals.
We know that about you. You're a hodler in the precious metals world. So I'm marrying the terms from both crypto and precious metals worlds here. But anyway, I appreciate your thoughts. Excellent insights as always. Thank you again for joining me today. Happy Thanksgiving.
Thanks, David. Nice to be with you. Always a pleasure.
Pleasure is all mine. And thank you for watching Kitco News. Happy Thanksgiving to you if you're watching this from the U.S. And stay tuned for more. Subscribe to our YouTube channel.